21 minutes before 9 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in this Friday morning. We've got 21 minutes to bring you the news. These are News Bites. We take the news from around the world, around the nation, around the state, and sometimes even from around town, and we tell you a shortened version of the news. We'll also tell you the news agency we're getting the story from so that you can look up the story and read it for yourself in the details. Many times, these stories are covered by more than one agency. And we'll begin with one from ABC News. The search area for missing Malaysia Airlines Flight 370 has shifted nearly 700 miles northeast after a new credible lead, according to Australia officials in a statement issued this morning at a press conference. Martin Dolan, chief commissioner of the Australian Transport Safety Bureau, said the search has a long way to go, yet the shift marks another setback in the three-week search, which was bolstered in previous days by satellite images showing possible debris. The shifting focus comes amid improved weather conditions, with 10 aircraft and 6 ships participating in today's search. One of the aircraft, a Royal New Zealand Air Force Orion, spotted objects today, according to Australian officials, but the sightings need confirmation by the ship. And if we hear anything in the course of the broadcast, we, of course, will let you know.
In the run-up to the Sochi Olympics, Putin went on a campaign to preach physical fitness and to sell his vision. He enlisted an American sidekick, the movie star Steven Seagal. Seagal is famous for beating up bad guys in movies like Fire Down Below and Under Siege. This appears to be a bromance fueled by testosterone and a mutual love of martial arts. Seagal explained the relationship on Russian television last fall. This is a quote from Seagal. The first time I walked into his home, I saw a life-size statue of Kano Yagoro, who is the founder of judo. So I was immediately taken and impressed and sort of wanting to get to know this man deeper and deeper. Putin is possibly the greatest world leader alive today, reported by CBS News.
And from the Associated Press, seismic signals showed there were two major slides about 4 minutes apart during Saturday's disaster in Washington State, and afterward, smaller slides continued for days, according to researchers at the University of Washington. A report on the landslide readings was sent to the U.S. Geological Survey and posted Wednesday on the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network blog by Kate Allstadt, a university researcher. The very rapid and energetic event was detected on 17 seismic stations ranging from 7 to 170 miles away. They showed the biggest slide started at 10:37 a.m. and lasted more than 2 minutes. This is the slide that caused the North Fork Stillaguamish River and hit the community of Oso, killing at least 25 people.
U.S. lawmakers yesterday grilled an Obama administration official on the government's decision to renew a contract with student loan servicing company SLM Corporation, the subject of numerous government investigations. SLM Corporation is popularly known as Sallie Mae. Massachusetts Democratic Senator Elizabeth Warren said during the hearing before the Senate Committee on Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions that the company had violated consumer protection laws, but not held accountable. This is a quote from Warren. Sallie Mae has repeatedly broken the rules and violated its contracts with the government, and yet Sallie Mae continues to make millions on its federal contracts with the Department of Education, reported by Reuters.
And from the Associated Press, two recent studies detail how rules on greenhouse gas emissions can have deep and negative economic consequences. An analysis by the Heritage Foundation in Washington, D.C. said new Environmental Protection Agency rules are likely to cost the United States an estimated 600,000 jobs and a $2.23 trillion hit to the gross domestic product by the year 2023. The gloomy report notes that families will also share in the costs as coal production continues to fall off, power plants close, and energy prices rise. If you look at what the EPA is doing, they are essentially promulgating and implementing rules and regulations that will drive out our coal production by prohibiting the construction of new coal-fired power plants and forcing the existing ones into an early retirement. That's a state from Nicholas Loris, an economist and senior policy analyst in energy, environment, and regulatory issues, who completed the study for Heritage.
The vast majority of Israelis polled in a recent study think Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has the best understanding of the complexities of the United States-Israel relationship, according to a poll released by the Ruderman Family Foundation. The poll focused on the relationship between Israel and the United States and was released ahead of the third Ruderman Fellows Knesset mission trip to New York and Boston, sponsored by the Ruderman Family Foundation and aimed at better educating MKs about the American Jewish community. This is a quote from the foundation. The American Jewish community plays one of the most important roles in securing Israel's future, yet this vital diaspora community is often not well understood by Israelis and their leaders. The Ruderman Fellows Knesset mission seeks to educate Israel's leaders to the diversity, pluralism, and changing connection of American Jews to Israel. We believe that this one-of-a-kind program will lead to a more nuanced relationship between Israel and American Jews, reported by the Jerusalem Post.
And this story from the Associated Press, a fourth person has died from injuries suffered earlier this month when a suspected drunken driver drove into a crowd at the South by Southwest Festival, according to police in a statement issued yesterday. DeAndre Dre Tatum was only 18 years old, died from injuries he sustained after being run over when a driver who was fleeing police crashed through a barrier and into a street crowded with festival attendees on March 13th. The Austin Police Department confirmed Tatum's death via Twitter and with a brief subsequent statement, but spokeswoman Vanessa Bremner said no further information would be provided. Tatum, by the way, was from Fort Worth. He was in crowd outside of an Austin club at the time of the crash. He was the last of the victims who had remained in critical condition at the University Medical Center in Breckenridge.
The U.S. Congress agreed to a major aid package to Ukraine yesterday, overcoming weeks of partisan disagreement that has held up around $1 billion in loan guarantees to Kiev. The Senate and the House of Representatives passed bills to approve a loan package to shore up Ukraine's unstable economy as it seeks to resist further intervention from Russia. The bills also allow for the imposition of further sanctions against Moscow over its annexation of Crimea and up to $150 million in direct aid to Ukraine. The U.S. support bolsters a much larger aid package from the International Monetary Fund of up to $18 billion. In total, the IMF deal is estimated to unlock around $27 billion in support from the international community over the next 2 years, including support pledged separately from the UK and Japan, reported by The Guardian.
And from the Associated Press, arriving fashionably late, a Russian spacecraft carrying three astronauts docked with the International Space Station last night, 250 miles over Brazil. The crew aboard the orbiting outpost congratulated the latest members, Russians Alexander Skvortsov and Oleg Artemyev, as well as NASA's Steve Swanson. A flawless approach, a flawless docking, according to Mission Control commentator Rob Navias. The trio blasted off from Kazakhstan on Wednesday, local time, aboard a Soyuz rocket for what was supposed to be a six-hour straight shot to the space station, but an engine burn designed to fine-tune the craft's path did not occur as planned, delaying the docking. Two rendezvous maneuvers were executed to put the Soyuz on course. The astronauts were never in danger, according to the report.
Nearly a million jars of peanut butter are being dumped at a New Mexico landfill to expedite the sale of a bankrupt peanut processing plant that was at the heart of a 2012 salmonella outbreak and nationwide recall. Bankruptcy trustee Clark Cole said he had no other choice after Costco Wholesale refused to take shipment of the Sunland product and declined requests to let it be donated to food banks or repackaged or sold to brokers who provide food to institutions like prisons. Court filings indicate the product was made with $2.8 million worth of Valencia peanuts owned by Costco and had been sitting in the warehouse since the company shut down and filed for bankruptcy last fall. After extensive testing, Costco agreed to a court order authorizing the trustee to sell the peanut butter. But after getting 8 loads, Costco rejected it as non-merchantable because of leaky peanut oil. So instead of selling or donating the peanut butter with a value estimated at $2.6 million, the estate is paying about $60,000 to haul the 950,000 jars of nut butter, or about 25 tons, to the Curry County landfill in Clovis, New Mexico, where Public Works Director Clint Butch says it will go in with our regular waste and covered with dirt, reported by the Associated Press.
It'll make it smell good, though.
Oh, yeah.
This is from Fox News. Several Democratic senators moved yesterday to improve parts of Obamacare, proposing numerous changes to the law amid concerns that it could cost Democrats House seats and possibly the Senate in November. The proposals came from a half dozen senators, some of whom are facing re-election in the fall, and most of whom represent moderate to conservative states. Since Democrats currently control the Senate, the proposals will put Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid in an uncomfortable position, forcing him to decide whether to put the bills to a vote or sideline them, despite the political risks for his party's incumbents.
A Georgia bank is asking a teenager to return $31,000 that was mistakenly deposited into his account. The problem is he may have already spent most of the cash. The Madison County Sheriff Office police were dispatched to First Citizens Bank in Hull, Georgia on March 18th concerning financial fraud. Their employee, Christy Bryant, explained that on March 7th, a customer named Stephen Fields deposited $31,000, but a teller entered the amount into another customer's account who had the same name. After receiving the mistaken deposit, Stephen Fields, aged 18, withdrew $20,000 and made $5,000 in purchases with his ATM card, as first reported by the Athens Banner-Herald. The deposit error was not noticed until original Stephen Fields complained to the bank of his missing money on March 17th. When the alleged deposit recipient tried to withdraw more money the next day, the bank informed him of the mistake that was made and asked him to return the money. But Mr. Fields claimed that the money was from an inheritance, reported by the Associated Press.
And this is from ABC News. Jimmy Carter has sent his first text message days after Jimmy Carter said he was worried about sending emails because they might be monitored. The former president sent his first text message, and it was about Stephen Colbert. Carter's grandson, Jason, who is a candidate in Georgia's Democratic gubernatorial primary, tweeted a photo of the first text message on Wednesday in which Jimmy Carter asked his grandson if he had seen him on the Colbert Report on Tuesday night. Carter then followed up with, quote, "That was my first text message," unquote.
A Nebraska model reported to jail Wednesday to begin serving her 45-day sentence on charges of indecent exposure after she posed naked in front of a Catholic high school. Valerie Dodd's attorney told reporters that her sentence is the most severe he's ever heard of on the indecent exposure charge. The 19-year-old said that she thought her actions were harmless, and they are definitely bringing the hammer as far as sentencing goes, reported by Fox News.
And the next story is loading, so let me do a plan B. CBS is reporting that autism in the United States remains on the rise. According to new government statistics, 1 in 68 children have an autism spectrum disorder, according to the new numbers that were released yesterday from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. The statistics collected in 2010 from 8-year-olds at 11 U.S. sites reflect nearly a 30% rise in rates of the developmental disorder over the course of only 2 years. The number of children diagnosed with autism continues to rise, according to Dr. Colleen Boyle, director of CDC's National Center on Birth Defects and Developmental Disabilities. She said that to reporters during a press conference yesterday. More is understood about autism than ever before, but these numbers are an important reminder for a need for answers. And again, the story from CBS.
Venezuela had the full attention of North and South American diplomats yesterday. The U.S. State Department issued its strongest response yet to the ongoing crises in the socialist country, saying it would consider imposing sanctions if the administration of President Nicolas Maduro does not reconcile with opponents who have been protesting for nearly 3 months. Meanwhile, a delegation of foreign ministers from South America was expected to issue recommendations that are aimed at easing the unrest. Maduro's administration announced that it had already accepted at least one of the suggestions, the formation of an official human rights commission that will report directly to the president and look into allegations of overreach. The oil-rich nation has been widely criticized for its harsh crackdown on opponents that are protesting inflation, crime, and shortages. Clashes between protesters and loyalists have left at least 32 people dead, reported by the Las Vegas Sun.
And the next story is from Fox News. Representative Mike Rogers, the powerful and highly visible chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, said that he will not seek re-election in the fall. The Michigan Republican congressman, who has been vocal on matters ranging from the overhaul of National Security Agency surveillance to the Benghazi terror attack, leaves after 7 terms in office. In doing so, he's taking a pass on running for an open Michigan Senate seat. Instead, he told Detroit radio station WJRAM that he plans to start a national radio program. It's a pretty rare opportunity, Rogers said. They don't come around every day. In a written statement, Rogers said he's been able during his tenure to turn the Intelligence Committee into a true legislative and oversight body. He added, quote, "I had a career before politics and always planned to have one after politics. The genius of our institutions is they are not dependent on the individual temporary occupant's privilege to serve. As I close this chapter in my life, I am excited to begin a new one that allows me to continue serving as a voice for American exceptionalism and support a strong national security policy agenda." The 50-year-old former FBI agent has been a frequent guest on TV and radio shows to talk about national security issues. Now, wants to have a radio show of his own.
Oliver McGee was a former scientific advisor to Bill Clinton. McGee has called for the aviation industry to update black box technology so that crucial recorded information is stored in the cloud and available for remote access. Oliver, who was also Mr. Clinton's deputy assistant transportation secretary, said using the internet to gather and store flight information in real time would mean that key data would not be lost. Even if MH370's black box is found, the voice data recorder is likely to be of limited use because it will only hold the last 2 hours or recordings, meaning that what was said when the plane changed course is unlikely to ever be known, reported by the Telegraph.
And then the next story is from ABC News. House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi refused to say whether she believes college athletes should be paid and able to unionize. Pelosi, who regularly sings praise for the professional athletes competing in the National Football League, Major League Baseball, and even yacht racers sailing through the San Francisco Bay, admitted she does not have a good enough grasp of the details to issue an opinion. "This is obviously very new," Pelosi said during a news conference in the Capitol, admitting she had just read about the decision. She said, "I have to see. I do think that the players should be respected and not exploited, and whatever use there is of the celebrity of a successful player or the work that they have put in to be such a good player to be respected," unquote.
New Jersey Governor Chris Christie is saying today that former aides were inexplicably stupid when they allegedly shut down lanes of busy George Washington Bridge and flooded a New Jersey town with traffic. The exclusive interview with ABC News' Diane Sawyer was his first television interview since his January press conference on the George Washington Bridge lane closure scandal. This is a quote from Christie. "When things were first reported, I said, this cannot possibly be true because who would do something like that? Sometimes people do inexplicably stupid things. And so that's what makes it so hard then, too, as the guy in charge. None of it made any sense to me, and to some extent still does not," reported by ABC.
From MSNBC, there's gold in them dry hills, or gold seekers anyway, and they see a historic opportunity in California's historic drought. Low water levels have led to a mini gold rush in the same Sierra Nevada foothills that drew legions of fortune seekers from around the world in the mid-1800s as amateur prospectors dig for riverbed riches in spots that have been out of reach for decades. With the drought going on, we're able to dig in more locations that wouldn't be accessible at later times, according to Tim Amavisca, who wore waterproof overalls as he panned in the Bear River near Colfax with his teenage daughter on a recent Friday afternoon looking for gold.
President Obama ordered the Justice Department yesterday to seek a 90-day extension of the National Security Agency's current phone surveillance program while Congress debates his proposed reforms. Mr. Obama said in a statement that he's seeking an extension of the current controversial program because the new legislation will not be in place by today when the authorization for it expires. Obama said the surveillance is needed given the importance of maintaining this capability to prevent terrorist attacks. The White House said earlier this week that it wants to move the collection of bulk phone records out of the National Security Agency and to place the responsibilities with phone companies. The extent of the NSA surveillance created a furor when it was revealed last year by former NSA contractor Edward Snowden, now a fugitive in Russia, reported by the Washington Times.
And finally, Sun and Fun is inviting you to have some fun with them, celebrating 40 years. Sun and Fun is an international fly-in and expo. If you like airplanes, you will like this event down in Lakeland. It's running from April 1st through April 6th. And if you want to know more, go to Sun and fun.org, and it's spelled with hyphens, sun hyphen the letter N as in Nancy hyphen fun.org, sunandfun.org. This is their 40th celebration anniversary, I should say. This is a fair in the air to remember, and it's down in Lakeland. If you want to know more, again, the website is sunandfun.org. That's all the time we have for News Bites. Remember, we do this each weekday morning. It's our opportunity to share with you the news so you can get on with your day and not spend all day trying to catch up on the news. And, Robin, how many stories did we get in today?
23.
Yep. All right, we will take a little break. Jim George is up next. We'll take a break and be right back.
Ocala's information station, 1370 WOCA. Ocala!
ABC News Now. I'm Daniela Bellotta. Searchers are trying to narrow the list of people still missing nearly a week after the mudslide in Washington State wiped out an entire town. 90 people remain unaccounted. Is it debris from missing Malaysian Flight 370? Planes have spotted three objects in the new area they've been searching, closer to Australia. But confirmation they're part of the 777 won't come until tomorrow. This didn't take long. Just 2 days after being added to the FBI's new 10 most wanted list, Juan Elias Garcia has been arrested in Nicaragua. He's wanted for the execution-style murders of his girlfriend and her two-year-old son on New York's Long Island. A Minnesota school agreeing to pay a teenager $70,000 after searching her Facebook posts after a parent complained about one. The ACLU says it was a violation of the then sixth grader's constitutional rights. H&M pulling a vest from its store shelves worldwide after accusations it was anti-Semitic, featured a menacing skull in the center of a Star of David. This is ABC News.
Make sure you're easy to find online with a mobile-optimized website from Hibu. We'll build you an eye-catching website that looks great on laptops, tablets, and phones. And we'll help more visitors find your site with $600 of free search engine marketing with Google AdWords when you buy a Hibu website's premium package. To find out more, visit Hibu.com. Hibu, made for business. Terms and conditions apply. Only available with the Hibu website's premium package, which includes design service, Wave Assist, and video. See Hibu.com. Offer ends May 31st. 3 months free search engine marketing with Google AdWords valued at $200 a month.
Here's something you don't hear on the radio every day. Someone who can't see. I am totally blind, and I go through periods where I'm unable to sleep at night and feel like I'm constantly running but can never quite catch up. But this isn't a sleep problem. It's something called Non-24. Learn about the link between total blindness and your symptoms. Visit learnmorenon24.com or call 855-856-2424.
Sponsored by Vanda Pharmaceutical.
The weather is brought to you by MyFWC.com. Life jackets save lives. Where in Florida? Variable cloud, it is warmer and more humid today with a couple of showers, mainly during the afternoon hours along the coast, the high 76 to 80. Partly to mostly cloudy tonight with a shower or thunderstorm, low 66 to 70. Tomorrow, mostly cloudy, warm and humid with some showers and a thunderstorm, high 80 to 84. For Sunday, mostly sunny and less humid, high 72 to 76. From the Florida Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Joe Lundberg.
Here's what you may have missed on the John Tesh Radio Show.
So if you lose weight, will your cellulite disappear? Nope, losing weight can diminish cellulite because there's less fat to pop out, but it will never go away entirely. Marriage isn't always exciting, and couples who understand that and who are confident they can stay happy with their partner even when things are dull are more likely to last. Talk as if your grandma is listening. Anything you wouldn't mention in front of her, don't mention at work.
Intelligence for your life on the John Tesh Radio Show. Don't miss this stuff.
Keep up with what's going on in the downtown area with Ocala Downtown Newspaper. Delivering thousands of newspapers to businesses in the downtown area, Ocala Downtown is there to keep you informed. They even have Tom's Picks, a free referral for people who are looking for a company to do work for them. Tom's Picks will refer the company that fits your needs, and all we ask in return is that you tell them where you heard about it. It's simple. For more info, just call Tom's Picks, 352-804-1223, and pick up your copy of the Downtown Ocala Newspaper today.
Now read Ocala Downtown Newspaper online.
Gene Powell Pasture Mowing. Our tractor services include bush hog, disking, front end loader, box blade, and stump grinding. We also have zero turn mowers for the smaller paddocks, aisleways, fence rows, and lawn care. Fence row spraying is also available for weed control. We are licensed and insured. Gene Powell Pasture Mowing, 352-629-2440 or online at PowellGene, G-E-N-E, at yahoo.com. Gene Powell Pasture Mowing.
Ocala's Information Station, 1370 WOCA. Ocala!